They said I was a miracle baby. I was conceived despite a 99% effective IUD. Then I survived the miscarriage of my twin. After that, survived a series of medical treatments that should have aborted me. No one knew that Mom was still pregnant. It was a world before ultrasound. A world of hippies, Elvis, psychedelic drugs, and Vatican II. Why am I telling you this? Because I believe this film is the reason I was born. After years of research and two other related films, I've come across shocking discoveries that help explain today's cultural chaos. And it finds its basis in mysticism. Mystics claim that all wisdom comes from inside you, that you're already God, a so-called spark of divinity, an immortal soul, that altered states of consciousness reveal true reality. That everything is one, and all religions lead to the same place.
God is manifesting himself in all the religions in some way and in different ways.
Yes.
And so we can transcend the intensity of the different interpretations by the experience of the oneness that comes through contemplative prayer.
Today, many universities offer courses in the Christianized form of mysticism called spiritual formation. Businesses and schools sponsor mindfulness meditation. Several U.S. states and Australia recently legalized various types of psychedelic drugs, while the U.S. government is funding its research. Science and religion are merging, reviving the ancient pagan belief system called shamanism.
The ayahuasca is usually described as a grandmother spirit, and I met her.
You know, our ancestors out there,
right?
And if you're open, we could use that.
Christ is not an individual. Christ is a collective.
Is man really immortal? Was Jesus just a man? If everyone experiences their own inner truth, then who makes the rules?
There's nothing to believe. You just go and you know it to be true for yourself.
Where did mysticism come from? And where is it taking us?
Saints of all religions, we bow to you all.
In a world of half-truths and beautiful lies, this may be the most important information you've ever heard. Stephanie was an ER nurse, and though she was raised in a Christian home, her faith was dead. In her late 20s, she found out from a non-family member who her real biological father was, and it seemed that everyone else in her childhood town knew, except Stephanie. She'd been lied to. Disillusioned and angry, she wanted nothing more to do with religion. Two years later, her beloved grandpa was dying and asked her to pray for him.
And I was ashamed that I couldn't give him what he was needing. And I was the closest to him. It broke my heart.
On top of feeling lost, she was also going through a breakup. The hospital chaplain somehow knew that she was struggling. She needed help. He invited her to meet with him.
And he was able to identify exactly what was happening with me, and I had not shared with him. It was at that time that I was in need of spiritual support, extra spiritual support. I felt very alone, and I was struggling.
Here, she learned about contemplative prayer and related practices for the first time.
One of the books that came recommended right away was Thomas Keating's book on centering prayer. And as the sound dissipates, so do your thoughts. It's really encouraged to just have one word, whether it be Jesus or God or whatever it is to that person. And it's just repeated until your mind goes blank. It's a form of self-hypnosis. And so from Thomas Keating, I learned how to go into the silence, how to banish the thoughts from my mind and go into that stillness and just be present with God. I was an emergency room nurse in a level one trauma center, so my life was totally consumed with chaos and craziness and noise and trauma and adrenaline. It was such a draw for me because it was the anti-type. It was the anti-adrenaline, the anti-chaos. It was very, like I said, peaceful and compelling. And it's just like your mind goes flat. Those brain waves just feel like they go flat. You're soaking in all that it has. You crave that time.
Stephanie pursued a deeper experience in contemplative prayer by going on weekend spiritual retreats and by learning to walk the labyrinth. The idea and purpose for labyrinths appears to arise in Mesopotamia around 2000 BC, the earliest certain dating for labyrinth-like drawings. Found on Babylonian tablets, which illustrate the coiled intestines of sacrificial animals, analyzed by priests for divination, that is, to read the will of the gods. By 400 BC, a single path square labyrinth appeared on Cretan coins, and by the Middle Ages, it was typically found in a circular shape, becoming a powerful symbol of mysticism. The outer circle represents the physical realm of linear time, while the inner circle is the timeless spiritual realm. The twisting, turning path is the apparent journey to deep within ourselves, tuning into God, the higher self, or ancestors, to obtain wisdom through an altered state of consciousness.
In a labyrinth, there is one way in and one way out. You don't have to think about it. Much like contemplative prayer, your mind is offline. It's passive. And I know my brain waves were in that alpha pattern because you feel the transition like that. And it's just a state that you, once you have experienced that, you know that state. The more you do it, the more you want to do it, the more compelling it is, and it becomes a driving force.
My name is Samuel Jacobson, but I was born as Samir Rahman Mahmoud in the city of Erbil in northern Iraq.
I also practiced Islam as a child.
I went to mosque, I read the Quran, I fasted during Ramadan.
Samuel and his family immigrated to Sweden as refugees to start a new life. But as he became a teenager in a new country, he felt lost. There was so much evil and injustice in the world. He decided that there was no God and stopped practicing Islam altogether. He packed his bags and moved to the USA and became a real estate agent in Los Angeles. He did quite well and had a comfortable life in Hollywood, but he had no peace.
I met a spiritual life coach. She was talking a lot about sort of the law of attraction. Within really just a couple weeks of working with her, I got a phone call from a client. He wanted me to sell a house for him, and the price of the house was $5 million.
After that, he practiced transcendental meditation and started doing yoga and hypnosis. And the more he went into New Age practices, it seemed that he was being more and more rewarded. He wore designer clothes, had a busy social life, flew in a private jet selling multi-million dollar homes for and to celebrities.
In 2016, I was top realtor number 24 in the nation.
My coworkers at the real estate company, they said, "What is your marketing strategy?" I didn't have a marketing strategy. I said, "I meditate, I get help from spirits."
A friend of mine had something called magic mushrooms. I don't know, I'd never done them before, and I said, "Let's try it." So I do magic mushrooms. Every time I did them, all of a sudden, I was transported into what I thought were past lives. One time I was a Roman soldier, one time I was a fisherman and my family, we were all sitting in a boat and the boat sank, and that's why I have fear of water in this life. That's how they explain like how these things from past lives continue on to this life. One time I was like a five-year-old during World War II and I was running around in Germany. Like, I was like, if these things didn't happen, how could I see those things? They felt very, very real. All of a sudden, out of nowhere, I got a new talent, if you want to call it that. I started composing music. I don't even know how to read notes.
Big round of applause for the United States synchronized swimming team.
And I was asked to compose music for the US Olympic team for synchronized swimming. And my music was played in the middle of Times Square.
In December 2015, my mother, who was living in Sweden, she died of cancer. And when she died, my world just collapsed. I also became interested in knowing what happens after we die. I wanted to get in touch with her.
Samuel and his adult niece, Vala, were very close through the years. She lived in Sweden and struggled with depression, drug addiction, and a past of childhood trauma. She was in and out of rehab and had attempted suicide several times.
What's the purpose of life? Is this just suffering without knowing who I am? Why I could not have a normal life? So yes, I tried this time. I thought if I cut my hands, that will be, I know for sure, I will die. So I cut both my hands, and the blood's running so much. So when I woke up, I saw everything was white. I thought, wow, finally, I'm dead. Well, maybe this, I'm in heaven. But that was not in heaven, that was in hospital.
A friend of mine says there's something called ayahuasca. They promote it as whatever it is that you're seeking, you will find it.
And he told me, Vala, now I have found something called ayahuasca.
You have to come. This is something that I think is going to help both of us. We've been best friends all our lives. I saw how she suffered in Iraq. She suffered in Sweden. I said, this is something that was going to help her. So before the ceremony starts, the shaman asks every participant to say their intention. Why are you here? What is it that you want these spirits to help you with? Some people were like, I want to find the right person to marry. I want my company to do well, or I want to get pregnant. I asked for my mom, and Vala asked for the truth.
The truth about who I am, the truth about why I am here.
So the ceremony starts. You drink this little black drink. It tastes like, you can't describe it, as disgusting. And they give you a little bucket, because everyone, it's called purging, everyone throws up, and they say, you're purging away all the negative stuff in you, all the past. All of a sudden, there is a very, very clear communication with these spirits. The first thing they said, we have certain rules here in the spiritual world that you must trust us 100%. You cannot even imagine the amount of success, just everything we're going to give you. There's one obstacle, and that is your niece. Vala is a child of darkness, and you're a child of light. You may not understand, but if we're going to be able to help you, you have to separate from her.
It's been said that he was the most photographed man in history. Elvis Presley flashed into the public consciousness with the looks, talent, and charisma that tapped into a restless post-World War II culture. Elvis became the highest paid actor in Hollywood and the best-selling solo artist in history. Though he didn't invent rock and roll, his unique style changed the world, almost overnight. Good to me. He was a money machine that ran relentlessly for 20 years. And then, he was gone. On August 16, 1977, 42-year-old Elvis Presley was found dead on his bathroom floor. Though the autopsy indicated heart failure, his death is now widely considered to be a result of his longtime prescription drug addiction. Near his body was a book called The Scientific Search for the Face of Jesus. It presents research about the Shroud of Turin, which many believe is the actual burial shroud Jesus Christ was buried in after he was crucified. I wondered why this book went out of print soon after Elvis died, And why was no online information available describing its contents? What really was in that book? Did Elvis find hope there? I had to find out. When I looked online, the only used copy for sale was on eBay for just $15,000. I also couldn't find a digital purchase option. Then, I looked and found 8 libraries in the U.S. that had a copy. Unfortunately, the folks at Franciscan University in Steubenville, Ohio, were kind enough to allow me to drop by the St. John Paul II Library. The staff gave me access to their conference room, where I was finally able to hold and read the book that Elvis was reading just before he died. The first half of the book includes evidence that the Shroud of Turin was the authentic burial shroud of Jesus Christ. While there are more recent sources of information regarding the shroud, the last half of this book is still unique. There, the author speculates on how Jesus' soul could have left his body after dying on the cross and then later re-enter the shroud before his resurrection. To support his conclusions, the author presents examples of reported out-of-body journeys of the Catholic mystic Maria de Agreda and of the 20th century psychic Edgar Cayce. So who was Maria de Agreda? She was a Franciscan nun and author whose best-known work is titled The Mystical City of God, which she claimed to have channeled directly from the Virgin Mary. During the years 1621 to 1631, Maria reported hundreds of out-of-body experiences, referred to by the Catholic Church as bilocation, from her cloistered convent in Spain to the New World, visiting Indian tribes in parts of what is now Texas, New Mexico, and Arizona. The natives described mystical apparitions as a lady in blue who came from the sky to teach them. How did this happen? Like her countrywoman, Teresa of Avila, Maria was inclined to a type of mystical prayer called the Prayer of Quiet, a form of mystical meditation which can lead to religious ecstasy or a trance state. It was during this meditation that she was said to bilocate and was also reportedly seen levitating. The most documented psychic of the 20th century, Edgar Cayce, also demonstrated signs and wonders through mystical meditation, which he admitted was self-hypnosis. As a young man, Cayce found that he could enter a self-imposed trance and apparently leave his body, sometimes to another state, to diagnose and prescribe cures for illnesses of people he'd never met.
He would read the body as though he were an X-ray machine.
From the early 1900s until his death in 1945, Edgar Cayce delivered more than 14,000 documented trance readings. Thousands of correspondents swore to the effectiveness of the treatments, all from a man with no medical training and only an 8th grade education. Adding to the mystery was the fact that he couldn't recall what he had channeled during a reading. So, with the help of his secretary, all of the sessions were written down while witnesses observed a reclined, self-hypnotized Cayce speaking in his own voice. No one seemed to question whether it was really Cayce speaking from his subconscious mind. Later, he began giving what he called life readings, which often gave people details about their past lives. Reincarnation was foreign to him. He was a Protestant Christian, and it went against everything he believed. He was troubled and said, "If ever the devil was going to play a trick on me, this would be it." Nevertheless, he chose to channel the esoteric doctrines anyway. In all, Casey, a man who knew nothing about Hinduism, Buddhism, or theosophy, would give 2,500 life readings devoted to metaphysics with reincarnation as their central theme. Scattered through these life readings were details about the life of Jesus of Nazareth, later compiled in the book Edgar Casey's Story of Jesus, written by Jeffrey First, who wrote the foreword to A Scientific Search for the Face of Jesus. What kind of Jesus did Edgar Casey's trance readings represent? That Jesus was just a man who had 30 incarnations during his development in becoming the Christ. He was the first human being to overcome death by finally perfecting himself and becoming a way-shower to help mankind learn how to tap into their own Christ consciousness, their own inner divinity. Christ was presented not as a person, not the world's Messiah predicted in the Bible, but as a presence that filled Jesus. Casey stated that Jesus was the greatest psychic of all time. Near the end of the book is a painting of the face of Jesus, which was said to incorporate details from the shroud, along with a description from Edgar Casey's readings. In short, the research about the Shroud of Turin was creatively used in order to promote a New Age Jesus. This book was the last of hundreds of occult books that Elvis read, beginning in 1964.
I went to Paramount's studio, brought him a couple of books, did his hair. Elvis was a voracious reader. We had a fabulous library that got bigger and bigger and bigger. Wherever he went on tour, two huge trunks were filled with his favorite books.
It all began with a little book, The Impersonal Life. His hairdresser, Larry Geller, who gave Elvis the books, stated that it became Elvis's Bible and that he gave away hundreds of copies. The book was channeled in 1914 by Joseph Benner, a Lutheran who believed it came directly from God.
In one of my other revelations called the Bible, very few comprehend my meaning. I have reserved for you thoughts and teachings, which I will give to you in secret. It is only when you can rise up in the realization of your divine immortality and can cast off all personal beliefs and opinions that you can free yourself. You need no mediator between you and me, for we are one already. I am, and you are, always have been, and always will be. I and you, reincarnate into humanity. Not until you are able to enter into your Christ consciousness will you be worthy and qualified to know and commune with your fellows in the great brotherhood of the Spirit.
These teachings closely resemble those of theosophy, which is a mixture of Gnosticism, Hinduism, and Buddhism, founded by Helena Blavatsky based on her interactions with highly evolved human beings, whom she referred to as Mahatmas, or the Great Brotherhood, allegedly gods in the afterlife. According to Larry Geller, Elvis believed he was being guided by these ascended masters, of which Jesus is just one among many. And according to a book by his former security guards, Elvis would sometimes read passages to his audiences from Blavatsky's book, The Voice of the Silence. It's a book that promotes Eastern Hindu meditation as a path to self-realization.
If thou wouldst reach the veil of bliss, disciple, close fast thy senses against this great dire heresy of separateness. Never did I not exist, nor you, nor will any one of us ever hereafter cease to be.
And we are part of God, the soul is part of God, the soul is God within. Are you taught? Go inside. God is in there. No. They say God is somewhere in heaven, you know, behind the clouds somewhere. He's far away. And he's watching very carefully. If you make a mistake, you're going to go, you know where.
Another of Elvis's favorites was the autobiography of Paramahansa Yogananda, a Hindu guru who founded the Self-Realization Fellowship. In 1925, the LA Times described Yogananda as a Hindu invading the United States to bring God, preaching the essence of Christian doctrine. According to Larry Geller, Elvis tried to join this group, which also quotes the Bible and prays to Jesus and other gods, including Yogananda, who died in 1952.
Heavenly Father,
Heavenly Father,
Mother, friend,
beloved God,
Jesus Christ,
Bhagavan Krishna,
Mahavatar Babaji,
Lahiri Mahashai,
Swami Sri Yukteswar,
Our beloved Guru,
Paramahansa Yoganandaji,
Saints of all religions,
we bow to you all.
You should feel that they are with you as you meditate and pray, and that such brings their magnetism to you immediately.
Meanwhile, the 1960s hippie generation experimented with free love and psychedelic drugs. While the Beatles practiced and promoted Maharishi's transcendental meditation.
When you let your mind go, whatever it's going, doesn't matter what you're thinking about, just let it go. And then you just introduce the mantra or the vibration.
But when you reach that point, because it's beyond all experience, then it's down there, and that level is timeless, spaceless, so you can be there for 5 minutes and come out. You don't actually know how long you've been there.
While he was in India, John Lennon wrote to a fan, "Transcendental meditation is not opposed to any religion. It is based on the basic truths of all religions. The common denominator, actual experience of God." Ancient mysticism was rising. Perhaps the biggest influence during this era was the Second Vatican Council, known as Vatican II, launched in Rome with more than 2,000 Catholic bishops from around the world. Vatican II helped pave the way for interfaithism, promoting unity between the world's religions by sharing the Catholic Church's mystic treasures, that is, its contemplative traditions. The council documents declared, "Since the contemplative life belongs to the fullness of the Church's presence, let it be put into effect everywhere." The term contemplative life was historically related to various monastic orders of monks and nuns whose lifestyles are oriented towards ascetic practices and contemplative prayer, a form of mysticism.
We were asked by the Vatican to get involved in dialogue with Eastern meditation and with Eastern monasticism as the area in which Christianity had the most common basis.
Couldn't we put this rich Christian tradition that we've experienced as monastics into a form that would be available for contemporary people who go for these how-to methods?
The packaging, in a sense, was influenced by Eastern methods of meditation.
And it's also a place where, incidentally, we've met the New Age movement a great deal because we've kind of integrated some of their ideas.
According to Vatican II, they would play the main role in the evangelization of the world. And that's exactly what happened.
And so I invite you now to close your eyes as the symbol of letting go of your own concerns for these 20 minutes. The centering prayer period is like taking a little vacation from ourselves and our concerns. We don't even think about God. We choose a symbol, which can be a word or the breath, perhaps an inward glance towards this presence. So the slightest movement towards this presence simply activates a presence that already exists. It's an exposure of our inmost being and the contents unknown to us of our unconscious that we're opening to God and to our deep self.
While he was promoting centering prayer, including at Protestant churches, Catholic monk Thomas Keating broke more ground for Vatican II's interfaith dialogue mandate. In 1984, he gathered a group of mystics from Buddhist, Hindu, Jewish, Islamic, Christian, and Native American shaman traditions to meditate together in silence and to search for common ground. After 20 years of annual meetings, the groundbreaking book, The Common Heart, was published. Some of their points of agreement included: ultimate reality cannot be limited by any name or concept. Spiritual authority is based in an experience of ultimate reality and comes from within. The individual soul is none other than the divine. We give authority to holy scriptures based upon our confidence in their ability to help others reach the greater authority, self-knowledge. These points of agreement are quite different from the major religions, whose teachings are very different from each other also.
You could say the fingers represent the five religions, you know, and they're separate in their doctrines and dogmas, like the fingers are. But the fingers lead to the center of the palm, and the various religions, on their deepest level, lead to the center of reality, where they are one, but they're different expressions of that reality.
The inner circle of mystics find common ground based on shared mystical experiences. Christians call it contemplation or silence. For Hindus, samadhi or bliss. For Zen Buddhists, satori. Different terms for the same thing.
As Bergson points out, we have the ability to know every event, the infinitely infinite number of events going on in all realms, all universes, and right here, now. If we're aware of that all the time, all we could be is that, and shed the bodies and everything. But that's what we are. And so entering into this meditation, I think so many forms of meditation bring you to that place, yeah, ultimately. Yeah, and it has different names, but it goes to the same place.
Jesuit author William Johnston wrote, "It is particularly relevant for our day, when science is exploring altered states of consciousness that are not unlike the states toward which the mystic points." Karl Rahner, foremost 20th century Jesuit theologian and engineer of Vatican II, emphatically predicted, "The Christian of the future will be a mystic, or he will not exist at all."
In engaging with contemplative prayer and this passive way of being, I felt it benefited me so much that I wanted to be able to learn to teach this to other people.
Stephanie enrolled in training programs referred to as spiritual formation, a curriculum based on ancient monastic practices with contemplative prayer as the foundation.
They advertise on their website that it's rooted in Christian tradition. When I get into the classroom, I'm in there with Wiccans and Satan worshipers and atheists, Buddhists, you name it, they were there.
Their studies included a form of Bible study called Lectio Divina, or divine reading, the goal of which is to prepare the mental faculties for union with God.
Lectio is a marvelous means because it tries to prepare all the faculties for union with God.
Union with God, or becoming one with God in an altered state, supposedly taps into the true self, which they say is the core goodness in every person, which is immortal and not separate from God. Catholic monk Thomas Keating leaves no doubt what mystics believe about the nature of man. God and our true self are not separate. Though we are not God, God and our true self are the same thing. Paul Netter is a well-known Catholic author, student of Buddhism, and former student of Jesuit theologian Karl Rahner. The unity between what I call God and myself is not just a case of God acting in me, but me being God. What Stephanie didn't know at that time is that Christian mysticism eventually requires a reinterpretation of the Bible.
What we're talking about is beyond human concept and therefore beyond human language. That means all the language that we hear from the Bible or in sermons, engage it, but don't take it literally.
Oh, well, he certainly isn't upset because someone bit into an apple. You understand? But I understand how you have to teach the mythic stories, but most people don't know how to understand sacred texts. They really don't.
Listen to the leading voices of this post-Vatican II movement describe what they say is true reality about creation, Jesus Christ, and the nature of man.
Most of us have not been taught how to distinguish Jesus from Christ.
We so lumped them together, and we lost the massive truth. In fact, what we lost was a basis for a universal religion, a natural religion. Christ is not an individual, Christ is a collective.
In fact, most Christians think it's his last name. They operate as if Christ is his last name, when in fact, it's a description of his function in history. We know the word means the anointed one. And that anointing began, we believe, with the first incarnation, right? The first incarnation, some billions of years ago, we now call the Big Bang, when God decided to show God's self. You want to see what I'm like? Voila, here it is.
In everything visible your eyes have ever seen. What else could it be but the body of God?
As Teilhard de Chardin taught in his day, every particle is filled with Christ. And we're just trillions of them put together with some kind of order by somebody.
This is the definition of panentheism, a Christianized form of pantheism or animism, where all of creation is penetrated with God's essence, which makes everything divine and worthy of worship.
And bow to them.
Even the rocks and the trees.
My own father, St. Francis, who's the first recorded person to speak of brother sun, sister moon, sister fire, brother water. It's all sacred.
While watching people on the streets, Catholic monk Thomas Merton had an epiphany. If only they could all see themselves as they really are, I suppose the big problem would be that we would fall down and worship each other.
The true mystic wants to kneel and kiss the ground every day. He lives, she lives in a sacred universe.
We're growing up in God, and evolution is the birth canal into divine life itself.
And the second coming of Christ is you, and the second coming of Christ is still happening. It's not one event, it's the rest of history.
Panentheism can be more clearly understood by one of its synonyms, incarnation.
The first incarnation is creation. The personal incarnation happened 2,000 years ago, we believe as Christians, which is Jesus.
He woke up fully to his divine consciousness, to the divine spirit that was given in his very being. And we are called to do the same. So Jesus saves by revealing rather than by fixing. In other words, he doesn't have to fix a rift between God and humanity brought about by sin. Rather, he reveals that there's no rift.
Jesus is fully human and fully divine at the same time. Impossible. And the price we've paid for that is most of us don't realize we are human and divine at the same time.
Jesus is the symbol of what human beings really are, an expression of the non-dualistic unity between divinity and humanity.
Buddhism has enabled me to come to a more non-dualistic understanding of an experience of God, a more unitive experience of the divine. So whatever God is, it's not out there, outside, other. It is what you are.
The vast majority of Western Christians, Catholic and Protestant, still think of God as out there because they have not had any inner experience.
The mystical, contemplative, non-dual mind. And I use those three words interchangeably. They are the same thing.
It's not just two. There's a communing, a fusing, where you become aware of the very presence of God in you and as you.
You can't see God because when you are God, there's nothing to see. So consciousness is perhaps all there is. But it's not self-consciousness, it's God manifesting himself, herself, or itself.
We're not individuals.
We or it, are all aspects of the same reality.
You and the other are one. Always have been, always will be. You just think that you aren't.
And it's this sense of separation from God that is the radical root of all evil.
So it's this habit of thinking we're not with God that has to be overcome. And since that's deeply, deep-seated, it takes a little time.
We got a lot of unlearning to do. And that's why we teach contemplation, because contemplation is mostly unlearning.
So it's not an external belief system that you believe something.
It's not believing in dogmas or going to church or following some moral commandment.
But a practice, there's nothing to believe. You just go and you know it to be true for yourself.
What could possibly go wrong with experiencing the apparent truth of non-duality, where you don't exist and everything in the physical realm is just an illusion? In his groundbreaking book, Zen at War, Zen priest and historian Brian Victoria shows how, during World War II, the Japanese military used Zen ideas and meditation techniques with the support of Zen Buddhist leaders. Soldiers learned how to attain enlightenment, or the no-self, a non-dual reality where neither they nor the enemy exist. And no one gets killed. This warrior spirit was inspired for centuries by the samurai, who also practiced Zen Buddhism. In the 1600s, Takuan, a famous Zen master, wrote, "The uplifted sword has no will of its own. It is all emptiness. The man who is about to be struck down is also of emptiness. The striking man is not a man." In the book Zen at War, the author quotes Lieutenant Colonel Sugimoto Goro, a huge influencer of Japan's youth during World War II. "The greatest mission is to promote an awareness of the non-existence of the self. Through my practice of Zen, I am able to get rid of my ego. Life and death are identical. Warriors who sacrifice their lives for the emperor will not die." Just before their final missions, kamikaze suicide pilots were told that they would meet again at Yasukuni Shrine, the permanent residence of Japan's warrior ancestors who died fighting for the emperor. This is the Yasukuni Shrine, a Shinto shrine in Tokyo, honoring over 2 million people. Shinto is the oldest religion in Japan, which arose out of the beliefs and practices of shamanism. During and after World War II, the Shinto priests performed rites to transform the war dead into gods.
Nippon no tame ni totoi inochi wo 犠牲された護衛令に対し尊崇の念を表し。So
how does the belief in non-duality, the no-self, coexist with ancestor worship? The answer is ancient shamanism. In her book, The Shamanic Bones of Zen, Zen priest Earthland Manuel states that voodoo and Zen are the same thing, because they are rooted in shamanism, where ancestors are everything in nature and can be communicated with, including dead people. Buddhism was a path where I found myself communing with ancestors and being guided by them every day. Chanting and meditating opened up a channel between me and the voice of the earth.
This work is both ancestral work and divine work. We become very intimate with the spirits that we call on regularly.
I believe so many of them work through us. Why would we not honor the people who have been stolen from us and are asking for us to fight for them.
If you do not know what libations are in African tradition, they are a pouring of a liquid as a deity to honor, commemorate.
This movement is much more than a racial and social justice movement. At its core, it's a spiritual movement.
So Breonna Taylor!
Breonna Taylor!
Ashe!
Ashe!
When we say the names, that you kind of invoke that spirit, and then those spirits actually become present with you.
You channel the spirit of Malcolm.
The speech is over. I'm gonna call a cut.
Sitting inside the house.
But he keeps going.
If it explodes, then the house is going to be destroyed. I said the house is going to be destroyed. So the Honorable Elijah Muhammad.
And he kept going for another 5 minutes till finally the film ran out of the magazine. And the stuff that he said was better than Malcolm's words.
He prepared a year for that role. Denzel knew he had to be in a space spiritually where Malcolm come in his vessel.
I would just pray every morning, you know, before I came out of that trailer, like, Malcolm, come on, you know, because it's not for me, right? You know, it's for him and for those, hopefully, that he affected. Another one of those characters, but especially that scene where I just went to prayer. I just called on all the spirits of all those who had been beaten. Not that I represent them, you know, and some people might think it goes wacky, but that's all I did. I just said, come on with me. I just want to go out here and represent y'all in some kind of way. You know, our ancestors out there,
right?
And if you're open, we could use that. If there's anything I can say to actors, that's what's worked for me more than anything else.
I could feel that even that Buddhism itself was almost a blanket, you know, even though it came from Buddha, but how it got transmitted, it was a blanket with a lot of things underneath it. And I think people will, if they understand the shamanism and within the Buddha, where it came from and all the indigenous cultures that contributed, if not created, some of what we're practicing, it will bring it into the context of the earth and seeing ourselves as earth, yeah, as nature, and understanding life. So shamanism, they know that. Shamans know that.
But the fingers lead to the center of the palm, and the various religions on their deepest level lead to the center of reality, where they are one, but they're different expressions of that reality.
Shamanism is not a religion. Rather, it's been described by religious historian and author Merche Eliade as the mysticism within each religion. It traditionally involves going into altered states of consciousness and through that state speaking to deities on behalf of one's community. The number one grossing film of all time is Avatar, which initiates viewers into the beliefs and practices of shamanism, the original mystics.
Aitukan.
Aitukan. He's the clan leader, but she's the spiritual leader, like a shaman.
That is Mother. She Itzakik, the one who interprets the will of Ewa.
So who's this Ewa? Who's Ewa? Only their deity. Their goddess made up of all living things, everything they know.
The Tree of Souls. It's their most sacred place. This is a place for prayers to be heard. And sometimes answered. The Tree of Voices. The voices of our ancestors.
Hear them.
They live, Sheikh. Within Ewa. The Great Mother may choose to save all that she is in this body.
Tingmikunai
She's real.
Grace.
Zen priest Earthlyn Manuel states, "All spiritual and religious paths are ancestral. We are being led to an alignment with the unseen. I am writing from a place deeper than my rational thoughts."
And every time I write a book, I go, "Oh my, what have I written?" Because it's coming from someplace, so then I have to study what I've written myself. It's phenomenal, you know, what comes through.
Shamans are awakened ones who can guide others to awakening.
You can experience freedom, like right now in this moment. Like in the moment, without the dogma. Even if you don't even know what it is, you can invite it until it shows itself.
But there's another question. How can someone be enlightened and still do violent acts? Isn't enlightenment supposed to be the highest pinnacle of spiritual development? The famous Zen master D.T. Suzuki admitted that enlightenment alone is not enough. Enlightenment in itself is just a state of being and can't tell right from wrong. The mindfulness movement is a secularized version of Zen Buddhism that has permeated U.S. businesses and schools.
This is a time of day that we don't need to change anything. We don't have to fix anything. We can just relax with what's going on.
Heavily promoted by celebrities like Goldie Hawn.
You can start training them very young, and they really love it. That's the other thing. Kids take to it like a duck to water. What we want to build is objectivity. Objectivity, interestingly enough, is looking at something with no designs, but you become a witness.
According to the authors of The Buddha Pill, there are only two root beliefs of mindfulness meditation. What is true and perfect lies within, and that your inner experience is fundamentally true. How is this possible when the most famous teacher of Zen Buddhism, from which mindfulness was derived, admitted that there is no basis of morality in an altered state of consciousness?
This is reality. If you look right over there, yes, everything is one. You have nothing to do with it. I am one with what I am. I can't tell you about it. If you can't see it, then you'll just never know it. I feel sorry for you.
Suddenly you notice that there aren't these separations. That's what death is going to be like. And oh, what fun it would be.
Since 2000, Johns Hopkins has been researching the effects of psilocybin, also known as magic mushrooms. One study of 36 volunteers revealed that a single dose could change a person's entire view of reality. Over two-thirds of the participants reported that it was either their number one or top five most significant spiritual experiences. And they often described aspects related to a sense of unity or unity of all things. In 2021, Johns Hopkins received the first federal grant for psychedelic research in over 50 years, joining the growing numbers who believe that psychedelics could hold promise for curing depression, anxiety, addictions, and PTSD.
I think generally people should be open to psychedelics.
Elon Musk tweeted, I've talked to many more people who were helped by psychedelics and ketamine than antidepressants and amphetamines.
As the new generation gets into political power, I think we'll see greater receptivity to the benefits of psychedelics.
But why in this secular research are so many experiencing what they believe are spiritual answers to the meaning of life? Not everyone is convinced yet.
I mean, Rick Strassman, he terrified himself right out of the DMT research, as far as I could tell, because all his subjects came back and said, well, you know, I went somewhere else and saw aliens. It's like, well, it was a dream. No, sorry, wasn't a dream, was way more real than any dream. In fact, it was actually more real than life. We don't know what to do with that.
In the meantime, psychedelic tourism is becoming mainstream.
Trust it, and you have to trust yourself enough to let go, to just surrender.
Nothing glamorous about it. It's all a part of sort of making you vulnerable so that you surrender to the experience.
My intention the first night going in was, I want to feel what pure love feels like. Surrendering to any of the lessons that needed to come through.
The Green Bay Packers quarterback talked about traveling to Peru on an ayahuasca retreat.
The ayahuasca is usually described as a grandmother spirit. And I met her and walked with her through past, present, and future lives.
Ayahuasca is a plant-based psychedelic that is consumed like a tea. The active ingredient in ayahuasca, known as DMT, is illegal in the United States.
I had a magical experience with the sensation of feeling 100 different hands on my body imparting a blessing from what seemed to be my ancestors.
So I went down there, did the whole ceremony, and he explained the ayahuasca plant. You think about what you'd like to have healed, and you blow into it. And the shaman said,
what's going on?
He said, do you see the geometric shapes? I said, yes. He said, if you really focus in on the emptiness between the lines, I just like astral traveled into blackness. I saw my mom. I saw my brother John.
The shaman asks every participant to say their intention. Why are you here? What is it that you want these spirits to help you with? I asked for my mom, and Vala asked for the truth.
It looked like everyone had a good experience, but for me it was completely dark. Cold. I felt I was scared. But shaman told me, this is your first time. Tomorrow will be better. They told Samuel that I am this child of darkness and we need to separate. I did not understand. Samuel is my only friend.
So the other way those spirits, they won my trust, my full trust, is what it looked like my dead mother. And she talks like her, she acts like her, and...
My mother came down in a spaceship. She knows my soul. So when I asked her about who I am, she said, of course. She's around me, her wings are everywhere. She protects me every day, every day.
My mother was my everything. So if my mother is telling me something, of course I will do, because I know she only wants what's the best for me.
Ayahuasca is very intelligent. I was able to tap into that. My sister had a... I saw as beginning stage of breast cancer in her left breast. And I texted her that. And it was amazing that she's been to the doctor. Like, there was a health thing, possibly a big health thing. It keeps reconfirming the message of that I can see visions, that it's real. And it's just like, I love that. I love channeling that.
So you have great ocean views. The downside is you have the freeway in between, so you're not on the beach side.
And also, these spirits were delivering. The last home I showed was a price range that was above and beyond what I normally do. It was a home in Malibu for $50 million. So I do about 12 ayahuasca experiences, and most of them were the same. Mine were, you know, my mother would come through, she would tell me how much she loved me, how great it is on the other side. My understanding was my mother died, and now she's with these spirits. They're helping me because she cares so much about me.
The last ayahuasca ceremony that Samuel and Vala attended was at Mount Shasta in Northern California.
The ceremonies are always done two nights in a row, Friday night and Saturday night. So we do our Friday night ceremony. I remember asking Vala, I said, how was your Friday night? And she was sad, she was crying, she had really terrible anxiety. She says, I don't know what to do with it. I said, how come this ayahuasca that seems to be able to help everyone except for her? And about 20 minutes into the ceremony, Vala started making noise, and I just felt she's disturbing everyone's journey because everyone is on this like inner journey. And the shaman goes over to her to help her because she's not feeling well, and he's using a musical instrument. What he's doing, actually, he's calling on these spirits, and Vala tells him, stop this music, and he won't stop. And she says, stop it. He will not stop. Vala grabs the instrument from him, breaks it in two, and starts beating the shaman with it. I am in shock. These spirits are speaking words into my thoughts, and they're saying, look, what is it that we told you? She cannot be trusted. She's a child of darkness. She hit the shaman, and who knows what else she's gonna do.
Jesuit priest William Johnston states, psychedelic drugs seem to introduce people to a level of psychic life that has something in common with Zen and mysticism.
There's nothing to believe. There's nothing to believe. You just go and you know it to be true for yourself.
So whatever God is, it's not out there, outside, other. It is what you are.
Elvis's favorite book says the same thing.
I, as the Christ, dwell in all men and am their one and only self. We could not possibly be separated, for I am you.
Christ is not an individual. Christ is a collective.
The same teaching of the forerunner of the New Age.
Christ is no man, but the divine principle in every human being.
But what if the Bible is true? What if Christ is a person who created the universe, who became a man on a rescue mission, who gave accurate predictions long in advance so we would know that he is God and we are not? Near the northern shore of the Dead Sea, in the area of Qumran, three Bedouin shepherd boys were herding goats when one of their flock went astray. While looking for it, one of the boys came near a cave, and like any curious boy, he threw a stone into the cave. Upon investigating, he found a simple collection of clay pots. One of them, broken by his stray rock, had some scrolls spilled out of it onto the cave floor. Though unknown to the boy then, It was the single greatest discovery in the history of biblical archaeology. These were the first of the Dead Sea Scrolls. From 1947 to 1956, hundreds of manuscripts were discovered in 11 different caves, dating from the 3rd century BC to the 1st century AD. Researchers were astonished that they were nearly identical to the Old Testament Bible we know today, including fragments of the Book of Daniel. More copies of the Book of Daniel were found than most of the other Old Testament books. The oldest copy of Daniel was dated 125 BC, though the original, or the autograph, would have been much older. The ancient Hebrews required many cycles of copying and distribution, at least 100 years, before an autograph could be considered canonical or as part of the Bible. And the Qumran non-biblical documents themselves quote Daniel 12, verse 10, as written in the book of Daniel, the prophet. This reference to Daniel means that the Qumran community regarded him as a real historical person and as a prophet. 1st century historian Josephus and Jesus Christ also endorsed Daniel as a prophet. In his book Antiquities of the Jews, Josephus writes, "Let him be diligent in reading the book of Daniel, which he will find among the sacred writings, Daniel the prophet." And while giving his list of last day predictions, Jesus includes Daniel. "When you see the abomination of desolation spoken of by Daniel the prophet, whoever reads, let him understand." No book in the Bible has been more scrutinized and criticized than Daniel. Its detailed prophecies predict with mathematical precision over 2,000 years of history, such as the rise and fall of empires, beginning with the kingdom of Babylon. The exact time of the first coming of the Messiah, and the rise of the Antichrist after the fall of Rome. No human could guess these events in that sequence and have them fulfilled in that order. If Daniel actually wrote his book in the 6th century BC, as it indicates, then it proves that there is a God of history who controls the course of nations. Stephanie was out on a walk with her new boyfriend, Dondi. She wanted to share with him her practice of walking the labyrinth.
I had no idea at the time what it was all about. She started walking the labyrinth and explaining all these things to me, and I thought, wait a minute, this doesn't sound biblical to me.
Back in the 1990s, Dondi hit rock bottom. The party life wasn't fun anymore, and he was desperate for hope. Stumbling onto a book about answers to prayer, he wound up at the home of well-known author Roger Morneau, a former demon worshiper who became a Christian prayer warrior.
I wanted to know what he knew and why his prayers were so powerful. We studied the Bible, we talked about prayer life, we talked about his experiences and what God has done for him. When I was there, I saw he had all these letters on his table from people all over the world. And he says, you know, he says, I realized that how truly little faith there was out there.
Dondi saw Roger's printer that had been printing without ink for several years. Roger was retired and had limited funds. He had asked God to help him print the thousands of letters he responded to, like this one. Ken had written to Roger in 1996 asking for special prayer, just like more than 25,000 people on Roger's prayer list. Your letter was read at least two or more times and presented before the Lord and placed on my perpetual prayer list, never to be removed. Ken was amazed that Roger had replied with encouragement and stressing the importance of reading from Matthew 27 every day. If we want power from on high in praying for oneself or for others, we must go where the power is to be found.
Every morning he woke up, he read this Matthew 27, 24 to 54, the power chapter in the Bible, as he called it. And that he, when he prayed for people, he asked for forgiveness first, and that he thanked God for appropriating to him that day the merits of precious sacred blood shed on Calvary. Then he would follow by the intercessional prayer for people.
Dondi was curious to look inside Roger's Bible.
And so I picked it up and I turned it to that chapter in Matthew that he talks about. And I mean, he had to laminate the pages just to keep them intact. I felt very in awe to hold that. And then to see that, and to verify that all the things that he talks about in his books, yeah, that's real. He told me, he put me on his prayer list. And when I left his place, I was convicted that everything was gonna be okay. It was that beginning of filling that void.
Roger died in 1998. He was confident that Jesus Christ, the great high priest, would carry on intercessions for the people in his prayer list. Because he lives forever, Jesus Christ has an unchangeable priesthood. He always lives to make intercession for them. Dondi started praying for Stephanie, applying the biblical principles he learned from Roger.
I was having difficulty keeping up with the readings, and the books weren't resonating with me. I even challenged some of the content with my instructors, who really did not appreciate that at all. When I questioned one of the instructors about how she could venture into Buddhism and still remain in the Christian religion, she says, well, I don't really see a conflict. God started opening my eyes. Something's not right here. I don't know what it is.
So how did mysticism come into the Christian church? We will see that it came from the same source as the belief in the immortality of the soul. Thomas Keating's centering prayer was inspired by the 14th century mystical manual, The Cloud of Unknowing. The anonymous author admitted his ideas came from another author, the same author that influenced the mystical theology of other medieval Catholic mystics such as Teresa of Avila, John of the Cross, Thomas Aquinas, and Meister Eckhart. to name a few. The author is now known as Pseudo-Dionysius the Areopagite, or Dennis, whose writings date to around 500 AD. Dennis presented himself as a disciple of the Apostle Paul, a pretense that was generally accepted until the late 1800s, thus giving his work an almost apostolic authority. Much of Dennis's work is based on the writings of Proclus, a Neoplatonist and one of the last directors of Plato's Academy in Athens, founded 800 years earlier. Thomas Merton, the famous 20th century Catholic monk, stated that Dennis was the real propagator of Christian mystical theology. Through Dennis, some of the most purely Neoplatonist elements enter into Christianity, and they are accepted without question. Merton describes Dennis's mystical theology as a transcendent and experienced theology. It is passive, invaded, and possessed by ecstatic love. Ecstasy is a complete break with sense, with intelligence, and with the self. Catholic mystics refer to ecstasy, or contemplation, as a foretaste of the beatific vision, which Catholics believe is the immediate experience of God after death. Jesuit priest William Johnston explains, "Death is the door to the ultimate ecstasy. In the lives of the mystics, we find foretastes of this final beatifying ecstasy." In other words, Johnston is saying that the core of mysticism is the belief in the immortality of the soul, which came to Western civilization through Plato, a mystic himself, who describes the soul and the related practice of mysticism in the Phaedo. The soul is in the very likeness of the divine, and immortal, and intelligible, and unchangeable. Do we believe that there is such a thing as death? To be sure. And is this anything but the separation of the soul and body? The one aim of those who practice philosophy in the proper manner is to practice for dying and death. If we are ever to have pure knowledge, we must escape from the body. And does purification not turn out to be, namely, to separate the soul as far as possible from the body, to dwell by itself both now and in the future? So for Plato, purification was ascending to contemplation, tapping into his subconscious mind, where his supposed immortal soul resides.
And you are moving toward the deeper subconscious self, which is where the soul abides in the subconscious.
Anything that could prepare the mind to enter an altered state, to obtain, as Plato says, pure knowledge, was the purpose for ascetic practices and monastic societies, such as founded by Pythagoras in the 6th century BC. Pythagoras greatly influenced Plato and is most known for his mystical school and belief in reincarnation and the immortality of the soul, and was said to have remembered previous lives. Historian E.R. Dodds, in his book The Greeks and the Irrational, calls Pythagoras a Greek shaman, meaning that he experienced altered states and apparent out-of-body travel. Tradition ascribed the so-called Pythagorean theorem to him, though an archaeological discovery of cuneiform tablets dated between 1900 and 1600 BC proved that the theorem was known in Babylonia more than 1,000 years before Pythagoras was born. The same time and place where the first organized system of astrology emerged. the cradle of civilization, where the first known temples also appear, called ziggurats, or cosmic mountains. Four-sided pyramids with steps to the top. It was believed to be the center of the world. Ascending the ziggurat was symbolic for rising to the heavens.
And that first and most important instruction is to have the spine straight so that we can most easily ascend our consciousness and life energy up that spinal highway to the infinite.
At the summit, through altered states of consciousness, the shaman priest could meet with the gods, deified kings and queens in the afterlife. In their books, The Worship of the Dead and The Two Babylons, the authors provide conclusive evidence that the original pagan gods were once men and women in Babylonia, whose attributes after death were later applied to the sun, moon, and planets and became the very foundation of paganism, that is, nature and ancestor worship. The priest also practiced divination, using mathematics and astronomy as sacred sciences. Just like Pythagoras, an initiate in the Babylonian mysteries, the primal source of the mystery religions that would follow in Egypt, Phoenicia, Greece, and Rome. Inside the Vatican Palace is a famous painting called the School of Athens, which was completed in 1511, celebrating the ancient Greek philosophers Plato, Aristotle, Pythagoras, and many more. It's no surprise that such a painting exists in the Vatican, for we've just seen that the Greeks are the source of mysticism and Christianity, and the belief in the immortality of the soul. The early church fathers of the Catholic Church, such as Jerome and Augustine, leave no doubt. The immortality of the soul and its continuance after the dissolution of the body, truths of which Pythagoras dreamed. For we made selection of the Platonists because they had the wisdom to perceive that the human soul, immortal as it is, cannot be happy except by partaking of the light. The ancient Greeks' legacy of mysticism also appears to include psychedelic intake. In the annual Eleusinian Mysteries, a religious event near Athens, Plato and other ancient Greeks fasted and drank a potion of a specific dose that gave them heavenly visions. Many believe this potion contained ergot, from which LSD is derived. In the Phaedrus, Plato describes the experience. We were initiated into that which is rightly called the most blessed of mysteries. We looked upon perfect apparitions which we saw in the pure light, being ourselves pure and not entombed in this which we call the body. Through mysticism, by meditation, psychedelic plants, fasting, music, or chanting, the initiate, like the shaman, seems to transcend human limits while in trance and to learn the apparent truth of an immediate afterlife, the practice of dying before you die. It was Pythagoras, through Plato, that brought these shamanistic ideas to Western civilization. While others seemed to find help from ayahuasca, Vala's experiences resulted only in darkness. She desperately wanted to know the truth about reality and the purpose of life. During the Saturday night ceremony at Mount Shasta, her darkness was suddenly arrested, and the truth began to shine.
When you are in God's presence, you know He opened my eyes and I saw exactly everything like you see me. The demons are real. They're laughing. You are so stupid. You don't understand you have a creator, God, who loves you, but you love sin and lies. So the voice told me, go home, just leave everything. So he comforted me. I felt such a love.
In my heart, I decide, this is it. She's too dangerous. I cannot have anything to do with her anymore. She flew back to Sweden, and I blocked her from my phone.
The only thing I was just thinking about, the love I felt for the first time in my life. He knew everything about me. He showed me, like, when you computer, everything, like, just seconds. He just showed me he'd been with me. All my life, he'd been watching me. I love you. He loves us so, so much.
Vala is out of my life. And I go back to do more ayahuasca. I said, I know where I can get help. And this time, nothing. There's no communication. My mother's not there. Nothing. It's just nothing. Nothing is happening. I got really, really scared.
When I came back from Los Angeles, I started to pray for Samuel.
Samuel fell into a deep depression, and he became hopeless after hospitals, rehab centers, and drugs.
My father's side, they were devoted Muslim. They prayed to Allah every day. So I bought a Quran and covered my head and a mat. I went to mosque every day, looking, searching after this loving, loving God. I knew He was God, but something was not right.
Vala and I, we start talking again, and to my very surprise, Vala is doing very well. So I said, okay, we have a God, and because we're born Muslims, you go to the God that you know. I said, this is easy. I did this as a kid, so I also get a prayer mat, a Quran, and...
You know, the spirit, demons, I went so deeply in the spiritism, so they was turning on and off.
Though Vala was practicing Islam, spirits harassed her, just like they did to Amanda and Roger Morneau.
I was so scared, I could not sleep. I had the red, red eyes. I could not speak with anyone. They would told me, you lost your mind. So I went down on my knees and crying out again for help. Who are you? Help me. I want to know you. I want to know the hand, the love you showed me. I went back to sleep. I can't tell about vision or dream. But I saw Jesus Christ stood at the door with open arms, with the peace. And I just jumped and hugged him. And he said, I already defeated darkness. I am the way, the truth, and life.
2-3 weeks later, Vala calls me from Sweden again. And she says, no, it's not Allah, it's Jesus. I said, okay, it's Jesus. At that time, I had never opened a Bible. I didn't know there was a Holy Spirit. And also, as always, Vala, when she does, after she tells me something, she goes in prayer. And she was saying, God, only you can reveal the truth for Samuel.
What I have discovered to be true in the message of Jesus of Nazareth, I believe it's truth and it's real, it's important, but such good news will not be presented as the only or the final good news.
What do we mean by calling little old Jesus of Nazareth the Alpha and the Omega of history?
To formally say Jesus is God is bad theology, is incorrect.
If his students Richard Rohr and Paul Nitter weren't obvious enough, let's be clear what Karl Rahner, the famous Jesuit theologian and chief engineer of Vatican II, taught about Jesus and the nature of man. Rahner believed that the literal incarnation of God in Jesus is a myth, that Jesus was just a man, simply an expression of the non-dualistic unity between divinity and humanity, which can be realized and lived by all. But Jesus can't be just a man. He can't be just another teacher or prophet. Either he was who he claimed to be, or he was the greatest liar in history.
You Samaritans do not really know whom you worship. But we Jews know whom we worship, because it is from the Jews that salvation comes.
I know that the Messiah will come. And when he comes, he will tell us everything.
I am he. I who am talking with you.
Scholars have counted 300 or more Old Testament prophecies pointing to the world's Messiah, or Christ, who would come out of the Jewish nation.
You will offer the life of this creature to God as a sign.
The prophet Daniel, a contemporary of Pythagoras in the 6th century BC, predicted the exact year that the Christ would appear and the exact year he would be killed. In Daniel 9, the 70-week or 490-day prophecy provides the keys. Verse 25 says, "From the going forth of the command to restore and build Jerusalem until Messiah the Prince, there shall be 7 weeks, then 62 weeks. That's a total of 69 weeks. Using the Bible's prophetic time principle of a day for a year, we count 483 years beginning in the fall of 457 BC, when Artaxerxes appointed a scribe named Ezra to return from the Jewish exile in Babylon to Jerusalem with money to rebuild and with authority to restore Israel's autonomy and sacrificial system.
Hear the word of the Lord!
With no 0 year, we land in the fall of 27 AD, when a prophet named John the Baptist announced the arrival of the Messiah and his mission.
I baptize you with water, but someone is coming who is much greater than I am. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and fire.
And John gave this testimony.
I saw the Spirit come down like a dove from heaven and stay on him. He is the one who baptizes with the Holy Spirit. I have seen it, and I tell you that he is the Son of God.
John cried out, "Behold the Lamb of God, which takes away the sin of the world." Every Jew knew what this meant. It was a death decree. So when would the Messiah die? Verse 27 tells us, "Then he shall confirm a covenant with many for 1 week. But in the middle of the week, he shall bring an end to sacrifice and offering." If we let the Bible be its own interpreter, we find that God is the covenant maker.
Abraham, I am your God, and I will make my covenant between me and you, for I will make you the father of multitudes. Kings shall come from you.
A man of my age, how can I have a child? And how can Sarai?
Sarah shall bear you a son. and you will call him Isaac.
We have wood, but where is the lamb for a burnt offering?
God will provide the lamb.
Abraham, do not harm your child. For now I know that you fear God, seeing that you've not withheld your son, your beloved son.
God did provide the lamb for Abraham and Isaac, a symbol of his son, Messiah the Prince, who would die for a rebel planet. Jesus said, "Your father Abraham rejoiced to see my day, and he saw it and was glad." Then the Jews said to him, "You are not yet 50 years old, and have you seen Abraham?" Then Jesus said to them, "Most assuredly, I say to you, before Abraham was, I am." The Jews knew exactly what Jesus was claiming.
"I am the God of thy father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. I have surely seen the affliction of my people which are in Egypt, for I know their sorrows. Therefore I will send thee, Moses, unto Pharaoh, that thou mayest bring my people out of Egypt."
"But if I say to your children that the God of their fathers has sent me, they will ask, 'What is his name?' And how shall I answer them?"
"I am that I am. Thou shalt say, 'I am,' hath sent me unto you."
Jesus was claiming to be the self-existent creator, the lawgiver, the only one who could redeem a rebel planet.
"Written with the finger of God."
"I have told you this now, before it all happens, so that when it does happen, you will believe."
"Father, the hour has come. Give glory to your Son, so that the Son may give glory to you.
Dedicate them to yourself by means of the truth. Your word is truth."
"I was born and came into the world for this one purpose, to speak about the truth. Whoever belongs to the truth listens to me."
"It is finished."
"I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one goes to the Father except by me. Put your finger here and look at my hands. Then reach out your hand and put it in my side. Stop your doubting and believe." "My Lord and my God."
"It is by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, whom you crucified, but whom God raised from the dead, that this man stands before you healed. Salvation is found in no one else, for there is no other name under heaven given to men by which we must be saved."
"I persecuted the followers of this way to their death, arresting both men and women and throwing them into prison.
as also the high priest and all the council can testify. As I came near Damascus, suddenly, a bright light from heaven flashed around me. I fell to the ground and heard a voice say to me, Saul, Saul, why do you persecute me? Who are you, Lord? I asked. I am Jesus of Nazareth, whom you are persecuting, he replied. Now, get up and stand on your feet. I have appeared to you to appoint you as a servant and as a witness of what you have seen of me and what I will show you.
We are witnesses of everything he did in the country of the Jews and in Jerusalem. They killed him by hanging him on a tree, but God raised him from the dead on the third day and caused him to be seen. He was not seen by all the people, but by witnesses whom God had already chosen, by us who ate and drank with him after he rose from the dead. He commanded us to preach to the people and to testify that he is the one whom God appointed as judge of the living and the dead. All the prophets testify about him, that everyone who believes in him receives forgiveness of sins through his name.
So we've seen that mysticism and the belief in the immortality of the soul came into Christianity from the ancient Greeks, not from Jesus or the apostles. Whatever they taught had to agree with their Bible, the Hebrew Scriptures, which Christians call the Old Testament.
The people of Jerusalem and their rulers did not recognize Jesus. Yet in condemning him, they fulfilled the words of the prophets that are read every Sabbath.
Jesus taught that God is a person who is located in heaven.
When you pray, say, Our Father in heaven, holy be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven.
He prayed to God as a friend, just like Moses and Abraham.
I thank you, Father, that you listen to me. I know that you always listen to me. But I say this for the sake of the people here, so that they will believe that you sent me.
Righteous Father, the world does not know you, but I know you. And these know that you sent me. I made you known to them, and I will continue to do so.
So the Lord spoke to Moses face to face, as a man speaks to his friend.
With all my heart, I give thanks. I have seen it as you have shown it to me.
Meditation for them was conscious activity and often part of prayer. Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, my strength and my Redeemer. In their poetry, the ancient Hebrews used a technique called parallelism, where a phrase is repeated using different words in order to confirm the intended meaning. I remember the days of old. I meditate on all your works. When I remember you on my bed, I meditate on you in the night seasons.
The contemplative prayer for me was after I had been through all of the other traditional prayer. But for most people practicing this, that usually drops off and they just focus on the contemplative piece. It's a misnomer. There's nothing contemplative about it.
Famous Catholic monk Thomas Merton said, "It is in fact absurd and impossible to try to grasp God as comprehended by our minds. We must transcend ourselves by repetitive invocation of the name of Jesus." Nowhere does the Bible promote mantras, prayer beads, or chants, the mystic's type of meditation. And when you pray, do not use vain repetitions.
Every major religion, at its more mature levels, is trying to give you some kind of method to compartmentalize the mind, to put the mind to the side. Now, what they found out is things like mantras, chants, anything you repeat has that effect. Prayer beads are not unique to the rosary in Catholicism. If you've been to Asia, you find them all over Asia. If you go to the Islamic world, you'll see people on the streets with their prayer beads all over. Every religion has discovered that. Only Protestantism, which came along far too late in history, where we were really getting into the head and into sermons and words and Bible quotes and everything, it didn't understand that anymore. It's probably the only major world religion that doesn't have something like prayer beads or chants.
God's people in the Bible are not mystics. They're never found emptying their minds, using breathing exercises, intentionally pursuing an altered state.
Fear not, for I am your shield. Your reward shall be great.
When the God of the Bible speaks to a human, they're actively working, consciously praying, or sleeping.
I was in the city of Joppa, praying. And in a trance, I saw a vision.
When I returned to Jerusalem and was praying at the temple, I fell into a trance and saw the Lord speaking.
Notice that they were actively praying before the trance state happened. It was evident that God had a special message for them that required a visionary experience. The trance state itself is not inherently good or evil, which means that human faculties can be possessed either by God's Holy Spirit or by other spirits. Buddhist monk Thich Nhat Hanh wrote, "In Buddhism, our effort is to practice mindfulness in each moment. To me, mindfulness is very much like the Holy Spirit."
So, what are we learning today?
Qi. Internal energy. The essence of life. It moves inside of us, flows through our bodies, gives us power from within.
Is the Holy Spirit just another name for energy, chi, or prana in an impersonal, non-dual universe? According to the apostles, this could never be. They clearly taught that the Holy Spirit is a person who has a mind, is a witness, prays for believers, can be lied to or grieved, and like Jesus, can be blasphemed, which means claiming that he is not immortal God. There's only one way that a person can receive the gift of the only Holy Spirit, and it's tied directly to faith in Jesus Christ, who declared, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father except through me. He will teach you all things and bring to your remembrance all things that I said to you." We will now see how interfaithism promotes virtually the same worldview as witchcraft.
Who are we? And most people don't know. You came forth from God, your deepest DNA is divine. What you're doing in contemplation is moving to a level beneath your thoughts, at the level of pure being, the level of really what we call pure consciousness.
The mystical, contemplative, non-dual mind. And I use those three words interchangeably. They have the same thing.
It's not just two. There's a communing, a fusing, where you become aware of the very presence of God in you and as you.
So it's all a matter of awakening. It's all a matter of awareness. And if you're accessing the now, God, being, consciousness, what is, use whatever word you're comfortable with, it doesn't really matter. It doesn't really matter. It doesn't really matter.
Richard Rohr is consistent with the book, The Common Heart, a 20-year review of annual interfaith summits with Buddhist, Hindu, Sufi, Muslim, Jewish, Christian, and Native American shaman participants, where they agreed that God is too big to fit into one religion. Spiritual authority is based on inner experience, and a person's soul is divine. That holy scriptures are only respected if they lead to the greater authority, self-knowledge. These concepts about God and the nature of man are identical to witchcraft, a form of shamanism. Authors and well-known witches Lori Cabot and Sybil Leek explain.
The circle represents God and Goddess, or the Tao, the Force, the All. The five-pointed star represents your arms, your head, your legs, humankind. And all animals, all living beings on Earth is what that star represents. That means your knowledge comes from the circle, universal light, the God, the Goddess.
Author of 50 books on witchcraft, Sybil Leek wrote, "We seek ancient wisdom through psychic forces. We believe in reincarnation, the survival of the spirit after death. It is essential to our faith." The science of witchcraft is based on our ability to enter an altered state of consciousness we call alpha, the springboard for all psychic and magical workings.
And so entering into this meditation, I think so many forms of meditation bring you to that place, yeah, ultimately. Yeah. And it has different names, but it goes in the same place.
What do witches claim happens in the alpha state? We spontaneously visualize, see pictures, hear information, diagnose illness, send healing energy to others, travel back and forth in time, and create change in the material world. If this reminds you of Edgar Cayce's self-imposed trance experiences, it's because the same spirits are involved, masquerading in any form that fits a person's worldview. They don't care what a person believes, as long as you have an immortal soul, true self, Atman, higher self. That way you don't need a savior. You can save yourself.
And you are moving toward the deeper subconscious self, which is where the soul abides in the subconscious.
While he was in trance, the voice that everyone always thought was Edgar Cayce said, "The spirit of all that have passed from this physical plane may be communicated with. There are thousands about us here at present." From thousands of trance readings, the message came clearly. Through self, man will understand its maker. That understanding is given here in this state. Though many believed Cayce was a Protestant Christian, his practice and teachings were more like a Christianized form of shamanism.
It's the strongest psychedelic known to man, and Jerry was taking it to see if he could break his addiction. The full moon came to Jerry and asked him if he wanted to see why he was so messed up.
My grandfather was sexually molesting me, and I was three.
The moon told Jerry to go see his dead grandfather and have him explain why he'd done it.
And he said that he was sorry, and I told him I forgave him. The guy, the shaman, goes, hey, go to the moon. So I went to the moon. He said, ask her for a new one. So I said, Mrs. Moon, could I please have a new heart? You know, and she said, yeah.
This man claims his addictions are gone. What's going on? Is the moon a conscious being with healing powers? Did he really talk to his dead grandfather? Did he travel outside his body like Edgar Cayce and ancient Greek philosopher Plato claimed? The Bible is clear about the nature of God, the nature of man, and of a real enemy of mankind. These are fallen angels, powerful beings who appear in any form to deceive and put people in bondage. They can also remove addictions, which they put there to begin with, in order to apparently prove that created things, or the spirit realm, are gods that can solve our problems.
These demons had chosen me, actually. I was chosen by them to promote New Age. And I was very loyal to them because, remember, I thought it was my mother. I took the lie they gave me and I believed in it fully because it was so well fabricated. The shaman was calling me and asking about her. And he said in the 25 years he's been doing these ceremonies, he has never seen anything like what happened with Vala.
No one had ever asked before for the truth.
When Vala had gone back to Sweden, Vala had started praying for me. She was praying and praying daily, and God heard her prayers. She was able to stop the work of these demons. They were not able to communicate with me, and I also understand today why there was so much emphasis on Vala, that she was a child of darkness, get rid of her. They knew somehow that she would be an obstacle to their mission.
If they speak not according to this word, it is because there is no light in them. The Bible teaches that Jesus Christ is the creator of the universe, and though he sustains it, created things do not have natural immortality. That's why the Apostle Paul tells us we should seek for immortality.
The plane crash that took their lives was so severe that their bodies were unable to be identified. So they were buried here, together. Six young men. And 69 others. Who will not be on the field with you today. But they will be watching.
Most Christians think that the Bible teaches the immortality of the soul. Here's a popular text that seems to suggest it.
Remember me, Jesus, when you come as king.
I promise you. Today you will be in paradise with me.
Did Jesus go to heaven after he died on Friday? Jesus said to her, "Do not cling to me, for I have not yet ascended to my Father." Did Jesus contradict himself, or is there a translation issue? The original Greek manuscripts of the New Testament did not have punctuation. Punctuation began appearing in copies centuries later. Jesus never taught the immortality of the soul, and he clearly hadn't been to heaven yet by Sunday morning. So the correct punctuation must be, I say to you today, you will be with me in paradise. The Apostle Peter tells us that even Israel's greatest king, the man after God's own heart, is both dead and buried, for David did not ascend into the heavens.
I anoint you king of all Israel, King David.
An old world will know there is a God in Israel.
The soul who sins shall die. For Jesus and the apostles, everything they believed about true reality was based on their Bible, the Old Testament. What does it say about the nature of man? Nearly 500 times the Hebrew word nephesh is translated soul, but never as immortal soul, because God alone is immortal. The word soul is holistic. It means living person. And the Lord God formed man of the dust of the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and man became a living soul. When a person dies, the complete opposite occurs. Then the dust will return to the earth as it was, and the spirit will return to God who gave it. In that very day, his thoughts perish. The dead know not anything. The Hebrew word for spirit is ruach, which means breath, not a conscious entity that goes somewhere in the afterlife. The apostles' faith was grounded in the resurrected and only ascended Master, Jesus Christ, who will come again.
And it is the will of him who sent me that I should not lose any of all those he has given me, but that I should raise them all to life on the last day.
Paul tells us plainly that God's faithful of all ages will receive immortality together on that day. I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. Finally, there is laid up for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will give me on that day. And not to me only, but also to all who have loved his appearing. In a moment, in the blink of an eye, the trumpet will sound, then the dead will be raised incorruptible. This mortal must put on immortality.
Lazarus! Come out!
This was a foretaste of the day when Jesus Christ will destroy death. So who's responsible for suffering and death? Jesus said, I saw Satan fall like lightning from heaven, the father of lies. Satan rebelled against God's government and was thrown out of heaven with his angels down to the earth and became the god of this world. Which brings us to the source of the controversy, the original lie. The hypnotic serpent medium tells Eve,
you will not surely die. For God knows that when you eat the fruit, your eyes will be opened, and you will be like God, knowing good and evil.
This is the fountainhead of mysticism. The serpent was saying that being awakened or enlightened means that you realize you're a spark of divinity or an immortal soul, that good and evil coexist in apparent non-dual reality.
So consciousness is perhaps all there is.
We're not individuals.
We or it are all aspects of the same reality.
They had developed through eating that tree what might be called the separate self sense. And it's this sense of separation from God that is the radical root of all evil, of all evil.
Catholic monk Thomas Keating says evil wasn't disobeying God. It was rejecting the supposed truth of non-duality. That's not biblical. It's Babylonian. The earliest written expressions of non-duality come from Mesopotamia. He made them neither male nor female. Enki was the god of the underworld and, like the serpent, a supposed friend and protector of mankind. The temple priests of Inanna, Enki's daughter, embodied her non-dual androgyny. Some unholy attendants for ritual head overturning, priest to become woman, priestess to become man. Through mysticism, the non-dual emphasis in the worship of Inanna, who herself was seen as androgynous, was that there are no boundaries in the universe. For thousands of years, Inanna, who was also Ishtar in Babylon, was worshipped as the Queen of Heaven and associated directly with the planet Venus. The famous occultist Helena Blavatsky tells us plainly who the goddess really represents. Every god and goddess of the ancient pantheons is androgynous. Our Lucifer, the morning star, being identical with Venus, is therefore the same as the Chaldean Ishtar. The Bible says that the worship of gods and goddesses, ancestor worship, or praying to the saints, is the same thing as worshiping fallen angels. Why? Because the dead know not anything. Religious historian Merche Eliade details how all ancient religions knew the Creator, but eventually, the supreme sky god everywhere gives place to other religious forms, towards more easily accessible forms, animism, devotion to the spirits of the dead, and local divinities. As Eliade shows, the world knew the Creator, but they made up their own narrative. That's why there are similarities to the creation and flood accounts of Genesis in every culture and history. But they're often opposite from Genesis as to who is the good God and true friend of mankind. The evidence from the Dead Sea Scrolls shows how the same God who revealed the future to Daniel could also reveal the ancient past through Moses. Without the prophetic gift, written history is nothing more than educated guessing. The mystics read the Bible as a means to an end, where inner experience is the highest authority. For Jesus, on the other hand, the Bible was the greatest authority, central to his teachings and his defense against every temptation.
It is written, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word of God. It is written, you shall worship the Lord your God, and but him only shall you serve. The scripture says, you shall not put the Lord your God to the test.
Jesus didn't try to prove creationism. He declared it. In the beginning, he created the male and female. The Sabbath was made for man. Jesuit Vatican astronomer Guy Consomagno says, religion needs science to protect it from creationism, a 19th century Protestant heresy. The ancient church fathers knew better than to interpret the Bible that way. Fellow Jesuit priest William Johnston explains, apparent twisting of scripture is typical of the mystics from Origen to John of the Cross. Growth and understanding comes from the mystics who live the scriptures from within. And let's be clear. According to the Jesuits, to believe in the Bible, like Jesus did, as an accurate account of history, including a literal seven-day creation, makes one a heretic. In the Dark Ages of the Roman Inquisition, being a heretic was a crime punishable by death.
As our Lord said, Hotan de elthe e kainos top pneumates ale.
Ah, spare us, I acknowledge your learning. Must you parade it before us?
I thought perhaps translation might cause offense.
What did he say?
When he, the spirit of truth, is come, he will guide you into all truth.
And that, young Tyndale, is what the spirit does, through the church.
But the church has so many persuasions. And what if the Pope is at variance with God's laws?
Then it were better to do without God's laws than the Pope's. Well, young sir, what do you say to that?
I defy the Pope and all his laws. If God spares my life, I will see to it that a plowboy shall know more of the scriptures than you do.
Tyndale confronted the Catholic Church on many things, including the doctrine of the immortality of the soul. The Pope joins the spiritual doctrine of Christ and the fleshly doctrine of philosophers together. And ye, putting them in heaven, hell, and purgatory, destroy the arguments wherewith Christ and Paul prove the resurrection. If the souls be in heaven, then what cause is there of the resurrection? O Antichrist! In 1536, the Protestant reformer William Tyndale was strangled and burned at the stake. His crime? Translating the New Testament Bible from Greek into English so that the common people could read it. Thousands of the Bibles he printed were found and burned. Only three copies survive today. Tyndale's translation work was later used for most of the King James Bible, the best-selling book in history. He wouldn't have given up his life for a theory.
Looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith.
He believed in Jesus Christ and the Bible as God's absolute truth for mankind. If Tyndale were alive today, he would be called a fundamentalist.
God is too big to fit into any one religion. God wants there to be many religions. religious diversity.
Pope Francis signed a document that says the very same thing. The pluralism and diversity of religions are willed by God. While referring to this document, the Pope called for a unity that transcends a mere political pact.
God is manifesting himself in all the religions in some way and in different ways.
Yes.
And so we can transcend the intensity of the different interpretations by the experience of the oneness that comes through contemplative prayer.
Accepting everything and everyone, and there's more than one way to God. So the spiritual formation practices really deconstruct doctrine, and it's meant to bring that false unity among different religions. What happens with this is it incorporates truth and error, mixes them so it looks beautiful. And then when you bring up fundamental truths of the Bible, we are seen as troublemakers, divisive. We're the problem. Not the fact that they're teaching error, but the truth is the problem and those who speak up for it.
After spending nearly 9 years in spiritual formation, Stephanie took a stand to leave. She married Dondi and soon began writing about the dangers of mysticism.
Satan would want us to all be stuck in the silence.
Stephanie is a fundamentalist, a term originating in early 20th century Protestantism to describe Christians who believe that the Bible is the absolute truth of God for mankind. Pope John Paul II tried to recast this term as evil, and in 1999, he urged an interfaith council of 200 religious leaders to condemn Christian fundamentalists. The group agreed that religious fundamentalists who refuse to go along with the global ecumenical movement are to be silenced. Karl Rahner, chief engineer of Vatican II, not so subtly said the same thing. The Christian of the future will be a mystic, or he will not exist at all. Sitting next to Rahner is Joseph Ratzinger, the future Pope Benedict XVI, who stated, "I had the honor of taking part at Vatican II as an expert, and my beloved predecessor, John Paul II, as a council father." The Jesuit Pope Francis, who says his spirituality comes directly from Vatican II, carries the same message. A fundamentalist group, even if it strikes no one, is violent. Fundamentalism is a plague. Fundamentalism is a sickness. Who believe in the absolute truth, we have to combat it.
We must be specially attentive to every type of fundamentalism. which sees only good or evil, or, if you will, the righteous and sinners.
He then asserted that the world demands that we confront every form of polarization which would divide it into these two camps. At the end of his speech, notice his suggestion for unity is one that sows peace in the contemplative style of Thomas Merton.
The mystical, contemplative, non-dual mind. And I use those three words interchangeably. They are the same thing.
So what is the Pope's pluralistic message for the world? Be a mystic, like Thomas Merton. Catholic monk Wayne Teasdale agrees. Mysticism is our most effective resource for transformation.
It's precisely the centering prayer practice, the non-conceptual prayer, that takes the manhole, you might say, off the unconscious.
We're growing up in God, and evolution is the birth canal into divine life itself.
Pope Francis mirrors the same pantheistic notion. All creatures are moving forward with us and through us towards a common point of arrival, which is God. Jesuit priest William Johnston adds, "The great religions share a belief in a common destiny. It is through one spirit, a common faith that is basically human. The belief that I'm okay and you're okay." The spirit Johnston speaks of is not the Holy Spirit. The Bible says that the Holy Spirit leads us directly to Jesus Christ, precisely because we're not okay. The heart is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked, for all have sinned. There is a way that seems right to a person, but its end is the way of death. The Tower of Babel is perhaps the greatest symbol ever of humanism, that is, mankind attempting to save himself. New archaeological evidence shows that the tower was real. Found over 100 years ago in what was ancient Babylon, this steel dates from around 600 BC. An inscription by Nebuchadnezzar himself states that he rebuilt the tower, calling it the Ziggurat of Babylon.
The building and its builder on the same relief.
Which clearly shows the seven stories and a layout of the temple on top. If it was rebuilt, then it was there before. Yi Tamanaki is generally believed to be the biblical Tower of Babel, a symbol of mysticism and organized rebellion against the God of Heaven. The Babylonians believed that their ziggurat was the center of the world. By climbing the stairs in trance, the ancient shaman priest was believed to transcend human limits and the created order. On every continent on earth, one can find the idea of ascending to the heavens, either in trance or after death, symbolized by climbing a mountain, a tree, a pillar, or a ladder. This symbolism would have been known to Abraham, who lived in Mesopotamia before God called him out of the land of the Ziggurat. Now Abraham's grandson, Jacob, who surely heard about the Ziggurats in Mesopotamia, is going back there to find a wife among his mother's relatives. He's afraid. One night, during his journey, God shows him the true stairway to heaven, with angels ascending and descending on it, and the God of Abraham standing at the top. When he awoke, he sensed God's presence and said, "This is the gate of heaven." The ancient Babylonians called their temple tower Babelu, or Gate of God. Jacob here is acknowledging that he recognizes the difference. He saw that the Creator of the heavens and the earth, who stands above and beyond creation, is the only God who can help us with our problems and the only God worthy of worship.
I'm guided by the hand that showed me the gateway to heaven.
It is you, God of my fathers, who wins the victories for your servant Jacob.
Jesuit priest William Johnston promotes a modern-day Tower of Babel. There are, I believe, many ways to wisdom. Each religion is a way. We must come together, form a single family, and build the earth. What material does he say builds their tower? The striving must be done in a passive way. High amplitude alpha builds the earth. Jesus describes two roads, a wide road that leads to destruction, and a narrow road that leads to life. The wide road, like the Tower of Babel, is fueled by mysticism, which leads to universalism, where everyone will eventually be saved. While the narrow road, like Jacob's dream, reveals Jesus.
I am telling you the truth. You will see heaven open, and God's angels going up and coming down on the Son of Man.
Jesus himself claimed to be that ladder between heaven and earth.
Who are you?
What I have told you from the very beginning.
Jesus warned that it would be false prophets wearing sheep's clothing, claiming to be Christians, who would be preaching the wide road message. And that's exactly what we've heard from some of the leading Roman Catholic mystics.
And the various religions, on their deepest level, lead to the center of reality, where they are one.
We are all aspects of the same reality.
God is too big to fit into any one religion. God wants there to be many religions.
So what is the end game of mysticism? If the greatest authority is based on inner experiences, then who makes the rules? In the end, it's a police state and the rise of the Antichrist.
The military curfew is now in effect. Return to your homes immediately.
We've already heard from William Tyndale, who identified Papal Rome as the Antichrist, as did Martin Luther and the other Protestant reformers of the Middle Ages. Let's be clear. We're talking about a system and not individuals. There are many sincere people who live up to the light they presently have. Many don't believe that the Antichrist exists today, that it's either already come or hasn't yet come. But the Bible says it arose about 1500 years ago, and that it will exist until the end of time. Some scholars have counted over 100 Bible clues. Every clue must fit, and only one system in history fits all the clues. Here are just a few. Earlier, we saw how Daniel chapter 2 predicted four successive world empires and the division of the fourth, which is Rome, into 10 kingdoms or 10 toes. Daniel 7 presents the same chronological prophecy with four beasts and the fourth growing 10 horns. Then Daniel 7 shows something next. A little horn rising up among the 10 other horns. The little horn emerges in Europe after the division of pagan Rome in 476 AD. It eliminates three of the 10 kingdoms of Europe, the Heruli, Vandals, and Ostrogoths. In 538 AD, Roman general Belisarius successfully broke an Ostrogoth siege of Rome. Though this was just one stage of a decades-long conflict in Italy, it was then that a new set of Roman laws, known as the Justinian Code, were enacted, making the papacy the supreme head of the only legal religion, the Catholic faith. This legal structure opened the way for the papacy to obtain its own civil authority and, through its allies, to persecute and kill heretics for over 1,000 years. Using the Bible's prophetic time principle of a day for a year, we see that Daniel and Revelation predict the same exact time period of persecution. 1260 years, beginning in 538 AD. The little horn is different from the other kingdoms before it. She's both religious and political. A woman is the Bible's symbol of God's people, while a harlot represents believers who step aside from Bible truth and embrace other religious ideas. He came out from us, but was never part of us. Revelation calls her the mother of harlots. The future Pope Benedict XVI said, "The universal Catholic Church is not the sister, but the mother of all the churches." She's called Mystery Babylon, a mixture of Christianity and the pagan kingdoms before her, and deceives the whole world by sorcery, which we've seen is powered by mysticism and the belief in the immortality of the soul. The logo on the cover of this Catholic Church catechism is of pagan origin and was adapted from a grave below the Vatican, symbolizing the happiness that the soul of the departed finds. On top of this foundation, they teach a Christianized form of ancestor worship. We believe in the communion with the dead who are being purified and the blessed in heaven. We can pray with and to Mary and should ask the saints to intercede for us. The family of the deceased learn to live in communion with the one who has fallen asleep by praying for him and with him. This is not biblical, it's paganism, because the dead know not anything.
Our beloved Guru,
Paramahansa
Yoganandaji,
saints of all religions,
we bow to you all.
What do we mean by calling little old Jesus of Nazareth the Alpha and the Omega of history?
To formally say Jesus is God is bad theology, is incorrect.
She's a blasphemer, claiming that Jesus is not God, while claiming to be God and also to forgive sins.
It's not just two. There's a communing, a fusing, where you become aware of the very presence of God in you and as you.
You can't see God because when you are God, there's nothing to see.
The Pope is not a mere man, but as it were, God. We hold upon this earth the place of God Almighty.
What can I do for you, Mr. Kowalski?
I'm here for a confession. Bless me, Father, for I have sinned.
What are your sins, my son? I absolve you of all your sins. In the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Thank you, Padre.
Only one of the Ten Commandments deals with time. The weekly seventh-day Sabbath, from sundown Friday to sundown on Saturday. Remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. 6 days you shall labor and do all your work, but the seventh day is the Sabbath of the Lord your God. From evening to evening you shall celebrate your Sabbath. Rome openly claims to have changed the Sabbath from Saturday to Sunday, which they say is the sign of their authority. The moral commandment inscribed by nature in the human heart, a sign. The Bible declares that the seventh-day Sabbath is the sign of the Creator's authority, and that His laws are inscribed on human hearts by the Holy Spirit, and not by nature, which is a pagan idea. Exactly 1,260 years after the legal transition in Rome, the Pope was taken captive in 1798 by Napoleon's General Berthier. The papacy lost her state sovereignty, but then regained it again in 1929 through the Lateran Treaty. The influence of the medieval papacy was, for the most part, confined to the sphere of Europe. But today, she influences the whole world as her deadly wound is rapidly being healed.
We must be specially attentive to every type of fundamentalism.
With the state of the world today, we need a moral voice like Pope Francis, the focus on humanity, is very critical right now, because there's so much polarization and divisiveness and conflict in the world.
In recent years, Pope Francis joined a coalition of leaders representing some of the largest and most powerful companies on Earth. According to the press release, the partnership puts the coalition members under the moral guidance of the Pope. Pope Francis presents what appears to be a kinder, gentler papacy. After all, he says his spirituality comes directly from Vatican II. Has the papacy changed? No. The right to religious liberty is not a supposed right to error, and has due limits which are inherent according to the requirements of the common good. In other words, religious liberty is not allowed for heretics, and is limited to what Rome says is morally correct. The Bible says that the Antichrist will once again have power to persecute and kill those who disagree with her philosophy and laws. But her authority will end when Jesus comes again. Do not fear those who kill the body, but cannot kill the soul, but rather fear him who is able to kill both soul and body in hell. Jesus is not talking about an immortal soul here, but that he is both judge and life giver.
Lazarus! Come out!
Who preserves the future of those who die for him, and removes the future life of those who reject him. They will be resurrected, judged, and then along with the devil and his angels, destroyed, and will forever cease to exist. The Bible calls this the second death because it's permanent. For our God is a consuming fire. God is not angry, he is holy. Sodom and Gomorrah are set forth as an example of eternal fire. They shall be ashes under the soles of your feet. The smoke of their torment ascends forever and ever. Just as Sodom and Gomorrah are no longer burning today, Revelation's symbol of smoke rising forever means that the fire has done its work, and the results of rebellion against God will never be forgotten. The one who created time and space, the only transcendent one, says, "I am Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end." The Lord speaks in prophecy that men may know that he is the living God, and that the events of this troubled world are in the hand of its maker.
I have told you this now, before it all happens, so that when it does happen, you will believe.
As we've seen, the mystics claim to be transcendent because they believe that their experiences prove the immortality of the soul.
And that first and most important instruction is to have the spine straight so that we can most easily ascend our consciousness and life energy up that spinal highway to the infinite.
We've also seen how this belief comes from the original lie in the Garden of Eden. In the end, it's a matter of possession, either by the Holy Spirit or by other spirits, the fallen angels. They have their spells. And the gospel is God's spell. It's a formula of words, a proclamation about Jesus Christ that is carried by the Holy Spirit into the life.
The Holy Spirit that we rely on, his teachings will line up with the Word of God. Not just a little bit, but everything, 100%. And that's how we determine the difference between the two spirits that we're hearing.
He told me to take his truth into all the world. I have followed his orders, saying nothing but what the prophets and Moses said would take place, that the Messiah must suffer, and that by being the first to rise from the dead, he would proclaim light both to our people and the Gentiles.
In the gospel, is the power of God unto salvation for everyone who believes.
I was flying private jets. I lived there for 17 and a half years. I was the last person to believe in Jesus, it's true. But he came into my life 2.5 years ago.
The peace and the joy that I have received with Christ surpasses, just the Bible, as the Bible says, surpasses all human understanding.
We may embark on a relationship with him from a decision, from the head, but when we get in that scripture and he speaks to us through his Holy Spirit, it goes to our hearts. And it's a heart relationship that spiritual formation cannot give. It's based on truth.
I don't get paid to stand here. I only do it to share the love of Jesus.
There is salvation in no one else, for there is no other name under heaven or given amongst mortals by which we must be saved.
So many people who have known me for many years, they don't understand how I could leave Hollywood and all this money and fame, and then they say, have you been brainwashed? And I answer them gladly. I said, yes, I have been brainwashed. My brain was filthy and it needed washing, and only Jesus' blood can cleanse us.
Thank you.